Sometimes I think he's a bit of a prankster in a way. I mean, I wondered today whether you're coming to interview me about him with some sort of weird, convoluted art joke.
Get there!
See?
Oh, I think with Ryan's work, you might get the joke, but it's not the only story within the work. So there's, you know, it is funny.
Don't look back, don't look back. Don't look.
But it's also quite serious and there's something going on there, which is more complex than that.
As part of a big National Trust project, Ryan's imagination has recently been let loose inside the Hampstead home of brutalist architect Erno Goldfinger, the man who designed London's infamous Trellick Tower.
Ooh, well, this is nice.
Yeah. It's funny to have a museum in someone's home. Feel like you're prying a little bit.
That's the nice thing about it.
Reaching through the drawers.
Is that what you felt like when you were making stuff for it?
Yeah, it was really hard to make the show. I was a bit in awe of it all, to be honest, because he's a bit of a hero of mine anyway. So I like those people who, you know, they think on a multitude of levels and they can swap skills. And Goldfinger did, you know, toys, he wrote books, he was an architect, a furniture designer, he was like a proper genius, a proper quick thinker, you know, sharp brain. But because it's a National Trust property, you can't sit on a chair or touch anything, really.
You can't kind of put something in that's going to mess it up.
Yeah. It's like there's a painting here, but it's a painting of the dirty marks around a painting that was there. And I took that painting away and reproduced the dirt. Because, you know, there's this historical argument with houses like this. Is the dirt of value? Was it his dirt? I mean, how far do you push it?
He's big on investigation into things. What art is about, investigation into trying to make a new language for art. Yeah, I think it's a hugely intelligent individual.
It's called The Way Things Collide, Fide and Book Meet Inner Soul.
Fide and Book Meets Inner Soul.
This house is in the book. And it's one of those daft coffee table books that's too big to read that you just have there to... Yeah. Another glass of champagne. And then I like the inner soul because you can't think of much more personal than an inner soul. You wouldn't go to a charity shop and buy some shoes and find someone else's inner souls and use them, would you? And these works are about taking two things, disparate objects that are opposites, and seeing how they collide together, seeing what sort of noise is made when they bang together. So they're called The Way Things Collide. So this is his office.
Nice.
Yeah, it's amazing, isn't it?
And this is
the chess set. And it fits.
It does.
It fits with the rest of the house, really, doesn't it? It's okay. A bit like he's left it.
But it's your chess set you have made.
The design for it is something that my dad told me when I was a kid. My dad used to work at Vauxhall's in Ellesmere Port, and he said the pieces from the underside of a Bedford truck would make really great lovers. And he was talking about these two. So the whole chess set's made of bits from the underside of a... engineered bits from a Bedford truck, but sort of misremembered and reinterpreted by my dad telling me this story. So it's this weird process of engineering meets art, the logical and the illogical coming together to make something that's functional, which is another contradiction, because most art isn't functional, is it?
No, and also it's a new use of a memory almost as well.
Exactly. I thought that this fitted here really well because Goldfinger was a great mind. And you all, you know, Sherlock Holmes played chess. All these great minds play chess, don't they? All I have to do now is learn how to play chess. I keep calling him the castle one, the vicar one, the dad, the mum, and the prawns. They're getting terrible with chess. Good morning, Tokyo.
Ryan's booming international profile means both he and his team are constantly travelling all over the world. He personally plans and oversees the installation of every new show or exhibition, Like music. And when time allows, he likes to check up on some of his major public commissions. Whilst also making sure that certain jokes haven't been lost in translation.
What Ryan does stays with you. It seems to cross borders incredibly well. He throws ideas off, idea after idea after idea.
Well, tonight's a book launch.
And the book is?
It's called Artist Cocktails, Ryan Gander, which is something that I put together. It's like 60 different cocktails, each one invented by a different artist.
But this idea that cocktails are like art, it's just a drink, isn't it?
Can be both. Mixing a drink, inventing a concoction, is a creative act, just like an artwork. Some of them are like very decent cocktails, but some of them purely conceptual. This is this incredibly conceptual. This is
That's definitely
Shrigley.
David Shrigley. It's two different cocktails.
Yeah.
The idea of the artist cocktail is both highly sophisticated and very Ryan. It's got a bit of Abigail's party about it, as well as the most glamorous night spots in the world.
The aspirational suburbia of Abigail's party is a British stereotype Ryan's very familiar with, having grown up here in this quiet corner of Chester.
It's a bit like the Wonder Years, isn't it?
Yeah.
You know, the title sequence, and it's, like, really nostalgic.
Yeah.
That's what this feels like a bit. Yeah, that was my house there. I guess when I was about 16, 17, we just made art in the garage. My dad cleaned it out, and we had it as a... Me and friends had it as a studio. We'd just go and sit in there on a Friday night and smoke cherry tobacco and make art.
So where did you make the leap from beautiful suburban aspirations to own another house like this to becoming an artist or wanting to be an artist?
That is a hard question. I sort of fell into it. There was a friend called Max who lived in Hall up the road, and his mum made paintings, and we were always around his house. And so that family was my introduction to art. The only thing I was really good at was, like, having ideas and trying to make things happen.
Like?
Like going around the estate here with a small business where we polished shoes, me and my brother, like opening a disco in the garage and selling cups of Cherryade for 10p as a small business.
Actually, if you grow up in an environment like this, it's very, very secure and enclosed, it gives you something solid to spring out of.
Yeah, absolutely. If it was all colour and noise surrounding you, you wouldn't have time to think of things, would you? And it was a wonderful place to grow up, you know.
I think he enjoys the juxtaposition of his ordinary background with this kind of weird Miami Vice lifestyle that he has as an artist. And I think he enjoys the friction between those two worlds. And in a way, I think maybe his work's a bit like that as well. You know, it's like rubbing a... things that aren't really alike together.
Ryan eventually swapped his dad's garage for art school in Manchester, getting a first-class degree before heading off to the Jan van Eyck Academy in Maastricht.
Over there, then, you got an apartment, studio, technicians to help you, stipend, didn't pay fees. Amazing.
That's
amazing. Yeah. And I developed my own language as an artist there, you know. I went there making stuff that just looked like other people's work, and I came out making stuff that didn't look like anyone's work.
And when did you sell your first piece of work?
2005. It was called Is This Guilt In You Too? Car In The Field. It was a 50-second loop. The car was frozen, the engine was running, and it was dawn, so it was a bit like some sort of mystery cryptogram where you couldn't work out whether there was someone in the car or not.
It sounds a bit like, you know, those things, somebody's dead in a room and there's just water on the floor.
It was based on that.
Would you say that the fact that you are, to a certain extent, restricted by being in a wheelchair helps your imagination go to other places?
Yeah, it's like being in prison, isn't it? People who write novels in their heads. It's the same sort of thing. There's, but I mean, you could say that, but you could equally say being in a wheelchair is influenced my work as much as the fact that I'm from Chester, that I'm a northerner, or that I grew up in suburbia, or, you know, anything. I wear glasses, so it's got to be about the world and all the good things in the world.
A part of the world Ryan's especially attached to is his childhood holiday town of Llandudno in North Wales.
I love the cliché of it. All the British stereotypes seem to be pushed out of Britain to its edges, and they all remain along the coast. Every time. There was a work that I made that features this town that's called I Walk Teal Home, which is about a family from London with a girl called Teal. And something happens in the family and they go on a witness protection programme and they move to Llandudno. I made posters and I wrote the script and I did casting shoots, but I never made the film. So it was going through the process of making the film without ever making a film. And that was the artwork.
Ryan's here to install an exhibition at the town's Mostyn Art Gallery. It's a small show, but one that means a lot to him.
It's funny, like, that the last show that I did was in Tokyo and the next one is in Singapore and this one's in Llandudno. But this is the one I'm enjoying the most. And it's because it's here, it's the region where I'm from. All my mates from Chester are here, surrounded by people that I love in a very familiar place. Feels like a homecoming.
I can't think of anyone that goes at it harder. It feels like he has like an urgency to get things done.
I care about the contribution that I make to a bigger history. So these are like tiny drops in the ocean. But the bigger picture is the history of art. That's the thing that I most actively think about, worry about.
With a view to helping others shape art history too, Ryan has ambitious plans to open a pioneering art school near his home in Suffolk.
So, Ryan, you've got loads going on. You've got a show in Manchester, shows all around the world, you're constantly making work, and you've got this as well.
The idea is it's a charity. People would apply, and there'd be a board that would select based on need and based on potential. And they'd come here and they'd stay for 6 months and, you know, they wouldn't have to have a job, they'd just make art. It's that opportunity that I had when I went to Maastricht, in a way. That doesn't exist in Britain. I mean, you know this better than anyone, is best export is culture. Mm. Like music, film, like...
Yeah, fashion, art.
And there's just no provision to make sure that the future of that is secure, you know? It's because it's not really quantifiable in people's minds that culture is can be an asset to a country, you know? So, yeah, another little project to add to the list of projects, yeah. For the love,